everyone. Welcome to the debut recording of the Hot Seat program from Industrial Supply Magazine. My name is Kim Phelan, editor of IS, and my guest today is Ken Ramoutar, who is the chief marketing officer at Lucas Systems. These guys specialize in distribution technologies centered around AI, smart software, and voice. Ironically, however, the primary focus of our conversation today is not just technology, as you might expect. Rather, we're going to delve into one of the most serious headaches, if not the number one pain point experienced by industrial distribution executives today. That could only be one thing, and that is the issue of the incredible shrinking and changing workforce, which some say is the top source of anxiety among company leaders in America today. Lucas Systems has been paying close attention to the workforce deterioration and the major trends that are occurring among your warehouse employees. So I'm really glad to have the chance to hear your insights today, Ken. Welcome to the hot seat.
Oh, glad to be here, and glad to be here to talk about this important topic.
I think it's very important as well. And so without further chatter from me, how about we just go ahead and dig into this, shall we?
Sure.
Okay, well, Ken, it doesn't take a rocket scientist to realize there is something terribly wrong in the workforce today across every industry, and it's causing a lot of pain for distribution executives, as well you know. Your company has decided to do some extensive research about the warehouse workforce crisis. Would you just kind of start things off here by sharing some of the key revelations that your work has brought to light? And really, aren't we just talking about a shortage of workers?
Yeah, Kim, that's a good misconception, a good place to start. So it's not just about a shortage of workers. There is a shortage of workers, but there's more going on here. You're right that this is maybe the number one challenge that, you know, our customers are facing. But there's a fairly large, you know, dramatic shift happening in the warehousing and distribution workforce. And it's not just a COVID thing, but it's a sustainable long-term shift in how that workforce is going to behave and what it's going to look like in the future. And it's something we really feel, you know, distribution executives and managers really need to pay attention to. You know, the pains are pretty evident everywhere. As I said, it's a number one challenge for virtually all of our customers. But at the heart of the issue, Kim, is that, you know, we're seeing a shift now. The baby boomer population is retiring. Mm-hmm. And the replacement workforce is the Gen Z. And as you mentioned, there's less Gen Z. In fact, there's 4 million less Gen Z workers than there are baby boomers. Mm. And these Gen Z workers have a much different value system towards work. And so that's why Lucas has really been doing this kind of work to really try to understand what's going on with the workforce of the future. And we've been doing both quantitative and in-depth interviews over the past year. So the things that really stand out, there's really kind of four things in my mind that stand out, and we can dig into these.
Okay.
One is it's around the environment, both physical and mental, and there's a lot there that we should discuss. They have really strong feelings about that. Second, you mentioned tech, but they have very specific views around the kinds of tech and tech that is really suited at helping them do their jobs. And so there's a whole topic there. The third is really around training. And what this workforce of the future expects in training, and it's a little different than what most folks might think. And then the last, which is an interesting topic, which is, you know, all this talk about robots these days.
Yeah.
What are the views from these workers around robots? And so I'd love to talk to you about that.
Okay, great. Well, I think we're gonna dig into these things and kind of take them apart and dissect a little bit, but. As I look at the research report that you guys published, the number one light bulb seems to be the necessity of creating an environment that wins the worker. Tell me what that actually looks like. I'm sure you're going to fold in these four points to some degree. Talk about what the role of technology and what that plays in helping a distributor compete more effectively for warehouse workforce, because I'm really having a hard time, actually, I'll be honest with you, connecting the dots between, you know, how does more technology to learn make employees happier? To me, that sounds a little counterintuitive.
Yeah, I think it might, and it might come across that way to the audience. But let me dig into this bit. I think I can shed some light on kind of where the tech comes in. But there's a few things to talk about as we kind of get to the tech part. So one is, over the past few years, almost all industries, and especially distribution, has had to raise wages considerably, you know, for workers. And that's just to kind of keep afloat. Right. But even with these big wage hikes, they're not able to find and keep enough workers. In fact, the workforce issue is at a point where it's actually limiting many businesses, meaning that they just don't have enough people to get the work done, and certainly affects their ability to grow the business at the speed of which they can, because the market's really there. Yes. So, you know, in this role of tech, there's a few other things, you know, that the research really brought out. Now, one is, around this physical environment. The Gen Z workforce cares a lot about the physical environment. That's what the research says. You know, no longer can you run a warehouse that's where it's hot in the summer, cold in the winter, there's poor lighting. The Gen Z population just won't put up with this. And even we're seeing some of the shifts happening, and some operators are rethinking their warehouse space. They're putting in better areas for breaks, more natural lighting, better, heating and air. A lot of warehouses aren't air conditioned. No longer do they want to work in those warehouses. So they have a choice. And so that physical environment really does matter when you're trying to compete and attract workers. They're going to look around and say, do I really want to work in this warehouse?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. Also, this notion of physical stress. So, the tech has a role in this, but this is the number one complaint from workers, physical stress. In fact, 80% of the Gen Z population that we surveyed said this is the number one issue for them. And physical stress takes a toll, and it's one of the reasons there's a fair amount of churn, in the distribution business. But one thing that people don't realize, it's not just, this is a hard job to work in a warehouse, but there's also mental stress. And people don't really realize that workers have quotas to meet. That means working fast. That means, but accuracy now is a really big topic. There's a lot of pressure on the distribution business to be accurate. In fact, there's a lot of charges if you're not accurate. So that translates down to the workers, that they not only need to work fast, but they need to be accurate. So when you add on the physical stress, the mental stress, that's a really tough job. Yeah. But this is where the tech comes in. And we said, hey, is more tech really going to help? What the research is showing is that workers want tech to help them do their jobs. And if the tech helps both reduce the physical stress and the mental stress, they're all for it. And the younger population really, really values tech, but they want to see tech for them.
Right.
So what are some of these kinds of tech? Well, we're involved in the space. So some of it is things like voice-directed systems. So these systems direct workers where to go, what to do. It frees up their hands. It keeps their eyes up, because a warehouse can have, a lot of things going on, forklifts running around, stuff in the aisles. So safety, is one of their concerns. But I think the key for tech for the new workforce, it's got to be about them. It's not about monitoring them. It's about helping them.
Yes. Yes. We didn't really talk about this, but while I'm listening to you now, something that other industries are finding or discovering in their search to expand the workforce and the pool, grow the pool of eligible skilled workers, they're turning to what I would certainly consider to be the obvious, which is women. And I would think that this would be a natural fit for what we're talking about, because as more women come into what have perhaps been historically or traditionally male dominated, positions, how can you address how this would make a female worker happier in this environment?
Yeah, I think I think that's a great point. You know, about I think warehouses are having a lot of trouble attracting, you know, a female workforce. At least many that I've been in, it's fairly male dominated, and you know, because the work can be physical and also, you know, just taxing. But I think when we go back to the tech and look at, you know, the tech that really is geared at helping workers do their jobs, that's where I think it ties in. I think these jobs have to be attractive, right? And they have to be one that they can do both physically, you know, especially if it's a lot of lifting, it's a lot of walking around. So I do think the things that we talked about, environment, tech that helps them, those are some of the things that this population really values. And whether it's younger men or younger women, they're going to look at these things and say, do I really want to work here? And it's a place I can work for, you know, for a long period of time.
Right. Well, not to belabor it, but you've kind of, you know, brought to light and reminded me that it's like, they're all about this, right? They're all about, you talk about technology, they were, you know, these kids, you know, these young people, they grew up with this in their hand, you know, in their, yeah, in their cribs. They have these.
Right.
So
that's,
they're
right,
not afraid of technology. They embrace it more,
right,
than any other generation. So it's interesting. Now, speaking of generations, in addition to the headache and the anxiety of just finding and retaining workers to replace those retiring baby boomers that you were speaking about, you know, there's another issue that you brought up, which is training. Training in the warehouse is this huge albatross in terms of wasted efficiency and productivity, because we all know, you know, somebody's got to be taken out to devote themselves to the training of that new person. And I know you guys talk about the term zero training, and you have ideas about going beyond zero training using technology, which kind of like blows my mind. Is it really possible to onboard new employees with very little or no training required from that other employee?
Great question on training. It's one of the topics that came up a lot, Kim, when we talked to warehouse workers, but a slightly different view. You know, we at Lucas coined this word beyond zero training as a result of kind of a lot of research and hearing from workers. But let me explain a little. You kind of hinted on it, but let me explain what it's like to join, you know, a new warehouse and get onboarded, right?
All right.
So normally you get, you know, if you're a new worker, you get paired up with an experienced worker, right?
That's
a lot of service industries do that. And so, you know, and you follow them around for maybe 2 weeks, sometimes a month, and you learn your job that way, you know, kind of following from somebody who knows what they're doing. But when you look at that, that's a really inefficient process. And it's kind of painful for everybody. For the experienced worker, they're now having to drag along somebody and teach them. And so their productivity goes down. And for the new person, they're not productive for 2 weeks to a month to maybe get to an average level of productivity and comfort. And then when you add in the churn, you know, a lot of warehouse work is churning at, say, 25% a year right now. So they're just constantly doing this. So it's this huge impact on productivity, right? Just for the existing workers and for new people. And it just seems like it never ends, right? But you mentioned that the Gen Z workforce is accustomed to tech. They
Yes.
grew up with it. If you give them tech, they kind of know how to log in. They're constantly using apps. They're comfortable with things like voice. So we really need to leverage that, because they're going to jump right in. And they want tech, like I said, that makes them better every day. So the beyond zero training is not just come in and know how to use it, but this is concept of how does the tech actually make you better every day? How does it learn what you're doing and what you're doing wrong and help you? So I'll give you some examples.
Yeah.
What this Gen Z population told us a lot is that they want to be able to adjust and customize the tech so it fits them, right? And that's a different concept than how a lot of tech is rolled out today. It's rolled out and said, here it is, use it, and this is the way it works. And they don't have really much control at all. But for example, languages. Sounds like a simple thing, but in many distribution centers, you have people who English isn't their first language.
I've seen that, yes.
And so if you can tune the tech and say, well, can I use it in Spanish or can I use it in Arabic or Chinese? We have customers that have multiple languages working in the same warehouse, some workers working next to each other using different languages. And so that's just an example of making them comfortable. They can work faster, they interpret faster, they don't struggle with it. Even simple things like, can I turn this, is there settings that have like, you know, beginner, advanced, so that as I get better, I can utilize more and it actually makes me, or things that help me. Like if I say, I don't know what the item is, if I'm grabbing the right item, can I ask, our system's called Jennifer, can I ask Jennifer, is this the right item? And she can tell me.
Oh my gosh, wow.
So this is this notion of beyond zero training, which is not that I give you, you come on board and you don't need training. You're actually getting training. The tech is helping you, and it's helping you get better every day based on kind of your terms and the way you want it. And that's a big sort of revelation on this younger population, which is, let me add it, but give me tech that's flexible, that works for me the way I want it to work.
Right. That's incredibly sophisticated. but speaking of sophistication, we as a magazine are also hearing about the sophisticated technology known as robots in distribution quite a bit. What is your vision about the growing role of robotics in the warehouse? Yeah. And what bearing does this have on the whole workforce problem conversation that we're trying to solve?
I think it's a really relevant topic right now. As you said, there's lots of talk about robots, some good, some bad. For example, Lucas was just at ProMat 2023. That was in Chicago. This is a giant material handling show. Yes. And I counted roughly 40 to 50 robotics companies there. It's actually confusing, right? There are so many companies and there's nuances to the various robots. But the one thing that's not being discussed, Kim, that I think is relevant to this topic is one, how do workers feel about working with robots, right? Because it's not going to be likely that the use case is mostly going to be robots, introducing robots into the existing workforce versus a fully autonomous robotic warehouse system, right? That's probably not going to be the majority of warehouses out there. So it raises questions about the workforce. One is how they feel about them, and two, how do you make all this work together? How do you make the people and the robots all work together?
And safety, you know, that's a huge part of it.
So we really wanted to figure out, what do workers think about this topic?
Yeah.
So we did ask questions and interviewed, and the interesting perspective from the research. One is, the younger workers welcome robots if they do the jobs they don't want to do.
Oh, interesting. Of course.
So what are those jobs?
Okay.
Yeah, so they're open to the tech. But they're like, yeah, if that robot's going to do a long haul move, that's great. I don't really want to traverse 300 yards of warehouse to move a piece of material from one place. Why don't you have a robot do that? I'm good here.
I love it.
Or heavy lifting, right? Who wants to lift heavy stuff all day long, right? Great job for a robot, right? So the younger folks get it. It's like, if you bring this robot in and it does stuff that I don't want to do, I'm all in. Yeah. Now, you take the older generation. Not so keen on the robots. A lot more fear, a lot more uncertainty, concerned it will take away their jobs. You know, robots are a pretty high tech thing. Not too comfortable sitting working side by side. What if this thing does something squirrely? So what we're seeing is a diversity in views. But I think that the net of it is, especially with the younger workforce, the trick in introducing robots into the workforce is to do it in a way that really makes the workers' jobs easier. If you do that, everybody will want them.
Right, right. That's great advice. You know, as we head for the home stretch in this this interview, I always like to close with one message. What's the one big thing that, if you could just press it into our heads, what's your big takeaway and or call to action for the industrial distributor?
Yeah, I think this workforce, you know, the workforce of the future is going to go undergoing a dramatic shift. So the big message is that, you know, operators need to be taking action now. This is happening. This is already happening. And if they want to compete for the workforce of the future, they need to pay attention to many things that we talked about: physical environment, training, tech. They need to be doing those things now, because there's going to be a scarcity of workers for as long as we can see out. And competing for them is what they're all going to have to do. So how are you going to compete? You got to be doing things now. So the research is telling us a lot about what that future workforce wants. So it's time to take action.
Ken, I want to thank you for taking time for this interview. I know you're a very busy guy. I've learned quite a lot, and you've definitely left us with some critical yet actionable, doable insight on how to approach and fix our ongoing warehouse workforce problems. Last thing I want to ask you is, how can our listeners get a hold of you and get more information, maybe even access this report that you published from the research?
Yeah, so the report's available for anybody who wants to dig in and get some of the facts and figures and get another level of depth. We call this area of thought leadership for Lucas the voice of the warehouse worker. And you can go to lucasware.com and you'll see various different pieces of thought leadership. And you can download, we actually have a couple reports you can download. So I'd encourage your audience to go there.
Great. Well, thank you again. Folks, that's it for me. Thanks for listening in, and I'll see you next time on the Hot Seat.